additional cuts in out years. $185 million turned the reserves into, instead of holding relatively flat, to start moving upwards as we try to reshape the size of state government. Is that fair? Or, Mr. Painter, would you like to point out any other changes that are pertinent to our conversation today?
Madam Chairman, for the record, Alexi Painter, Legislative Finance Division. So making that one change reduces the deficits and increases the CBR balance in the future years. I don't think that's quite enough to turn it upwards, but if you do a little more, it would. The $185 million, just so people are clear, is the reduction below the governor's budget, which is the baseline, not from FY17. So it's actually a little more from FY17.
Senator Machicki.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Can you look at the, can you back out, please? So another thing, just to get us a little bit more toward reality, and remember we talked about, I mean, I know I put models up earlier prior to the spring forecast being released, and we said, well, what would this look like with $2 more a barrel? And by golly, the spring forecast came out and it was $2 more a barrel and the model worked even better than it had originally, right? I mean, we know we have some conservatism designed into this, and Mr. Thiel talked about that a little bit. But one of the things that's quite conservative is the 9% decline. I want to look at what is more probable on production. And you know, it's probably going to be $100 million of annual revenue just if you start considering that 2 years of decrease or increase, instead of being an anomaly, being more of a trend. And we've got a long list of new projects expected to be online by 21, delivered by DNR just last week. So could you add $100 million of other revenue on your summary tab? Doesn't,
oh, you don't, yeah, really through the chair, Senator Machicki, it's a little difficult to do that in a way that shows up. So if you don't mind, we can show that. It's just, we'll show it as additional budget reductions. It wouldn't be a budget reduction, but it, for the
I
deficit
think
calculation.
That's fair. So that's 285, right? So at that point, Madam Chair, you see us not falling below 5 and you start to rebuild our savings. I mean, in a nutshell, if I can just take a moment, Madam Chair.
Senator Machicki.
With our proposal is a $4.1 billion budget. We're essentially there. 2018, FY18 is, the spring forecast shows 1.83, 1.9 billion. That brings you to a 2.26 fiscal gap without this model, right? So this shows for FY18, what is your revenue? If you can back out on bottom right revenue. $1.996. That's a $272 million gap remaining for, just picking a year, it's a snapshot of a year, right? That $100 million you just put in brings us down to a $172 million gap. So I guess the point that I'm bringing here is that without doing anything else, we are to the point of balancing without yet plugging in a motor fuel tax or any of the other things that we've talked about. Could you back out and just click on motor fuel tax, which this model already shows building reserves and a shrinking use of the CBR? Up top is the motor fuel. You got that in already? Okay. And then could you drop the capital budget down to a more realistic number for what we're doing right now? And I don't, Madam Chair, I don't know if you're comfortable with $100 million. I mean, it's where we are. What we do in the future is a different discussion. So you see, by 19, we start increasing our CBR savings, and our earnings reserve starts growing rather rapidly. So I guess the point I'm trying to make, Madam Chair, is that when you hear things that it leaves a $500 million CBR draw forever with without significant changes, this just demonstrates that sort of what we're looking at doing right now builds the CBR, balances us within 2 years, and begins growing our savings fairly significantly. That's without adding in a $2. What if there is a $2 increase in the price of oil, which is certainly reasonable? Things start growing relatively quickly. So if I may, we started this conversation with a $4 billion budget deficit. Had we tried to respond earlier with revenue, taxes, and things like that when we had a $4 billion budget deficit, now that we're down to a 2.268 budget deficit, we would have overcapitalized this government. And that's why our model works, and that's why we are resistant for other taxes on Alaskans, if you will. We are on guard against overcapitalizing this government. And I know Senator Von Imhoff was going to talk about the spending cap and the revenue limit. Right? Those are all a concept of this plan that make it function.
Comments from committee members. Senator Bishop.
I haven't said nothing all morning. Good morning.
Good morning, Senator Bishop.
I usually don't say much, but I just want to throw something out here. And this is my personal opinion. I believe that last year, and it's as true as today in my mind as it'll ever be, but I think this is the beginning of sound economic and monetary policy for the state of Alaska going forward.
Thank you, Senator Bishop. Senator Von Imhoff.
Thank you, Madam Chair. One of the components of this plan is spending in the future. And Mr. Till, you made a comment. I would hate to think what would have happened if we didn't have $16 billion in reserves the last few years. I also think, though, had we had a spending cap in place and were following it, $16 billion in reserves, we would have probably had a few more in reserves right now. One of the components and the backbone of SB 26 is a spending cap, and right now we have it at about $4.1 billion for UGF. Some people call that, when you have the spending cap along with a revenue limit with a POMV, that's sort of belt and suspenders. I like that. I like redundancy. But they each have their own levers. If and when revenue increases someday, and I hope that it does, through a variety of mechanisms, whether it be the price of oil or diversified revenue, whether it be production, there may be pressure to catch up and spend more, particularly in capital, deferred maintenance, bring back programs that maybe have been put in the back burner. It will take discipline and resolve by future legislators not to do that, or to pick and choose and be thoughtful which programs to address or which capital and deferred maintenance to address. A spending cap will keep a level of discipline in place. And I think it is a core requirement for this plan. And I'm very pleased to see that it is in the SB 26. Senator Machicki, I think that's all I have to say on that subject.
Thank you, Senator Von Imhoff. Mr. Teal, did you have a comment?
I do, Madam Chair. Just the belt and suspenders. It's a good analogy, fair analogy. But I think if you don't understand, or if people don't understand why there are two different things, they act in two different ways. The revenue limit or the payout limit, whatever you want to call it, says if oil production, if oil revenue spikes, that we won't spend that entire spike, even though that spike doesn't go as high as the spending limit. So some people are concerned that that means we can't spend that money. Say you have $200 million that's cut off by the revenue limit. What it does is give you a choice. With no revenue limit, you may spend that $200 million right now. Or you could say, we're not paying it out. We're not increasing expenditures this year. Instead, it stays in the earnings reserve account. Because it's in the earnings reserve account, you get to spend 5% of it every year. So you have a choice between spending $10 million a year, basically forever, or $200 million once. That money doesn't go away. It's there for you to spend for deferred maintenance, or in, you know, if you could say, here's a spike, we'll spend it on deferred maintenance. It's a one-time cost, but we don't want to build up the operating budget. If you chose to operate under the revenue limit, that gives you $10 million a year that is continual and can support operating budget increases. Not that you have to increase the operating budget because you've got the money, but it's there for that purpose if you needed it and wanted to use it in that way. The spending limit is a little different. It just says when revenue gets really, really high, you can't spend it. It doesn't tell you what to do with it. It doesn't reduce your draw from the earnings reserve account like the revenue limit does. So they act in conjunction as opposed to, you know, a double thing. They work well together.
Thank you, Mr. Teel. Senator Hughes.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Can you scroll up to the top there? Okay. My favorite line, which will come as no surprise in the price scenario middle column, is I'm looking across. It looks like it's about line 8, 7 or 8, the target cut, of course, and that come no surprise. But I do think, and I appreciate the hard work, but the reduction factor in this model over time and the Senate majority's commitment to making reductions, I think, is incredibly important so that we don't have to go down in the revenue variable section to at least the minimal degree, or you know, as little as possible, to pull from people's pockets, whether it be a sales tax, income tax, et cetera. So I just appreciate that that's part of the model. It's the part of the model that I can truly support, and I think it's important. And I also resist what I'm hearing as far as the necessity to have the deficit be zero yesterday or zero today, because I do think that the downward pressure to continue to make reductions is important. And once you turn on a revenue spigot, the temptation will be to continue to turn it up instead of continuing to work on the reductions. So I just want to point out, I think that's a really important part of what the Senate majority is promoting, because we have to not just think about the necessary state services across the state, but we also have to think about the communities and the private sector, household budgets, and so I appreciate that factor, and hoping that that line 8 will continue to be there, and that is absolutely the best way to bring down that deficit. So thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Senator Hughes. Mr. Teel, thank you for joining Senate Finance today. Is there any further questions, Senator Meyer?
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. And I'd like to just follow up on Senator Hughes's comment, because she and I both sit on Labor and Commerce, and we are hearing the income tax bill quite extensively this week. And it, as proposed, it goes into effect in FY20, and it would bring in additional revenue as passed by the House of about $600 to $700 million. So what that shows me, if I'm reading this correctly, we're proposing about a $250 million deficit in fiscal year 20. So that would actually provide that would be a surplus of about $500 million if my math is good, or $400 to $500 million, which just means we'd be collecting more money from Alaskans than we need to. We'd be going back to having a surplus and probably going back to, as Senator Von Inhofe mentioned, going back to our old ways of spending more than we should.
Senator Meyer, the purpose of today's meeting, from my perspective, is that it is short-sighted to be thinking about an income tax at this point in time, that we have heard both from the other body as well as the executive branch that we have a dire need to fill the entire hole, as Senator Hughes pointed out, but we saw an almost $1 billion improvement in our position compared to last year in 365 days. And so I think the economists in the Labor and Commerce Committee have also said you shouldn't do everything at once. And the Senate Finance Committee, or at least myself, concurs that we shouldn't do everything at once. And leaving a deficit is not a bad thing if you believe that government still has an opportunity to do things more efficiently and provide services possibly differently than they are today. Senator Michicki.
Nick, Madam Chair, I just have one final point. I certainly, if you can scroll up and show the budget reserves, please. I certainly agree with that, as long as you do have a year's UGF in reserve. I mean, things can happen, and it proves with this model that we always have a year in CBR reserves. So, you know, we were always saved by oil in the past, and we see increasing production. We have another 150,000 barrels of likely production coming on. We'll have some decline as we have the increase, but we'll see a gradual increase most likely over the next several years. Oil's not going to save us. So $107 a barrel roughly is what it would take, right? We're not going to see that. I think if we see $80 a barrel, we're going to see $40 a barrel. I think we're going to, the best thing for Alaska would be to hover between probably 50 and 65. But what is reasonable is adding a couple of dollars just to look at it. I talked about that before the spring forecast came out, and it improved the model fairly dramatically. But could you add just $2 to spring forecast? So we're not talking about $50. We're talking about two.
Senator Michicki, through the chair, we with the new production numbers, we don't have any price possible. So what we can do is the P40, which means that there's a 60% likelihood, according to DOR, that the price is lower and 40% likelihood that's higher. That's a few dollars in the early years, and I think 8 or 10 by the later years. So it's a little more.
Okay.
Which we can see here. So it's $4 in FY18, up to $10 by FY26. So that's the higher scenario that we have.
That's the P40, and you already activated
right.
it?
Right.
Yeah, so just again, if you can scroll down to the bottom, pretty significant difference with $2, right? Across the board, four at the beginning. And so although we could see, we're going to see fluctuating oil prices, there's no question, but just any kind of an increase. So we purposely didn't run EIA numbers because we thought they were pretty rosy, right? We like to remain competitive or conservative in our assumptions, like essentially every slot in this line, but just another $2. So we're no longer talking about 50. We're not talking about $107. Why is that different? Because now we have a POMV draw that covers the vast majority of that gap. We're not counting on the revenue traditionally into the general fund. We have a steady draw, which eliminates that variability. It takes you off that roller coaster ride and onto something much more stable. So I, Madam Chair, just wanted to point that out. It in order for us to remain healthy, we had the spring forecast. We added a couple of dollars to it four at the beginning, and then it increases from there. But it just demonstrates that it is robust. We are not plugging unrealistic high numbers into production or price, and it remains very healthy.
Mr. Carpenter.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. To Senator Michicki and Senator Hughes' point, if we could paint another scenario here with, instead of the OMB 10-year plan of growth, if we would go to an inflation growth and just put in a 1.5% or 1% growth in the out years, and get rid of your P40 and go to a regular production, you kind of get to the same results with budget constraint in the out years. The OMB 10-year plan has flat in the early years, but then 2.5% growth after that. And if you just restrain your spending to something less, you get to the same point. And I would also emphasize again that the volatility in our projections is, I mean, we're $200 million plus or minus just next year. 10 years out is, I mean, to say that a $500 million deficit is not a balanced budget, I think is entirely inaccurate. Because I would say it could be on either side of that.
Mr. Carpenter, thank you for that. And it goes to the Senate majority's position that the administration does have in its power an opportunity to help Alaskans in a way that we may not see reflected on a piece of paper as of yet. Contract negotiations are handled by the administration and just sent to the table of the legislature to either approve or deny. And so there are tools at the administration's disposal that doesn't change the level of service, but does provide us an opportunity to help balance the budget. I do want to point out, though, that for those Alaskans that are following that may believe that we don't need to do restructuring or a POMV draw, the only way this works is because of the blend of the POMV and the improvement of the oil dollars. So when Senator Michicki points out $2 or $4 in production that we're coming out of the red and into a neutral state or into a budget surplus, depending on production, that is only with the use of the earnings being blended with those revenue projections. Otherwise, there is still a gaping hole. And so I just don't want folks to think at home. I have young adults, two young men of two sons that are watching what we're doing and want their dividend as it was in past years and do not see a reason why they should see less in their dividends. And I just want to point out for my family, as well as those that might be listening, that we would still be facing huge deficits if we did not choose to use a percentage of our earnings toward trying to blend the revenues together for the foreseeable future. So inside the next decade that these projections are forecasting, if we do not use the earnings which are shown in green bars in our savings, from the permanent fund earnings reserve account, we would be in huge, huge deficit still. So the point of today for everyone is that we can balance the budget from my perspective without additional taxes if we only base that on cuts. And if the Senate were to achieve the $300 million in cuts, no new revenue would be needed anywhere. That requires, from my perspective, a willing House as well as a willing administration to accomplish those cuts. The Senate has achieved $185 million worth of cuts that we will start negotiating with the other body. And so our model doesn't look as robust as the Senate might have hoped for. But there are still other ways that this can be impacted by legislation that's moving through the bodies. In many ways to affect the policy decision that affect these models' outcomes. And we will continue to pursue a responsible budget that includes a spending limit, that structurally reforms different programs that are huge cost drivers of the state, And again, reductions and a spending limit bring us to a conversation about the cornerstone of any fiscal policy, and that is use of the earnings reserve. Are there further comments from committee members? Senator Hughes.
Yes, I just wanted to add to what Senator Meyer mentioned based on what we've been learning from the economists and the fact that our income line on the model does not have a number in it. But in each of the experts that came before, I asked the question, if we were to implement such a tax, would it deepen and prolong the recession that we're in, because we are officially in recession, and they all agree that that likelihood was very great. And so I just wanted to point that out. What we want is a soft landing, and we do not want to put the economy into a tailspin. And I'm concerned about the proposal from the House majority that creating surplus would be very damaging to the economy. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Senator Von Imhoff.
Thank you, Madam Chair. One of the things that this model doesn't necessarily show is the economic impacts and the population impacts in the event that we institute an income tax, because people who have the most money are generally the most mobile. My aunt was a state representative for the state of Connecticut for over a decade, and when they increased taxes significantly, high wage earners left the state. And when four hedge fund advisors left the state of Connecticut, the following year, there was an impact on the budget. They actually noticed it when four people left. That could very well happen to the state of Alaska. Thank you.
Any further comments? Mr. Teel, any closing thoughts on Alaska's fiscal situation and SB 26?
I think Senator Michiki wanted was priming Alexi to do a run, so we'll turn to that. I don't have any closing comments. I think that it's really up to you to make a determination of whether you feel comfortable with the model, with the assumptions, and with the policy choices that are in front of you.
Thank you. Senator Michiki.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think our goal today was to clarify that there's not a remaining $500 million CBR draw forever that we've seen modeled. I mean, I think people want different things out of this government. I think people have different expectations. I know folks want to talk about larger capital budgets in the future, but right now we're talking about survivability and being able to deliver quality services that are required.